Well, this evening, let me begin by reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and I'd like to read beginning in verse 13, and then read through chapter 5, verse 11. And the reason I want to read through into chapter 5 is because I want us to see the connection between what's happening in chapter 4, when Jesus comes and raises the dead and gathers the living, with the day of the Lord, which is the day of his judgments. These are not two separate events, but this is what the Lord does in order to gather everyone together for that final judgment. So this is what we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning in verse 13. He says, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Now, as to the times and epochs, brethren, you have no need of anything to be written to you, for you yourselves know full well that the day of the Lord will come just like a thief in the night. While they are saying peace and safety, then destruction will come upon them suddenly, like labor pains upon a woman with child, and they will not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you like a thief. For you are all sons of light and sons of day. We are not of night, nor of darkness. So then, let us not sleep as others do, but let us be alert and sober. For those who sleep do their sleeping at night, and those who get drunk get drunk at night. But since we are of the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us to wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we will live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up one another, just as you also are doing." Let me just mention, too, that what Paul says here can be a little bit misleading, because he is focusing on those who have died and those who are alive in the Lord Jesus Christ and what's going to happen when the Lord returns. This could lead us to believe that this is somehow a separate event than the general resurrection of all men, which we just read about in John chapter 5, or that only parts of humanity are going to be raised and gathered on that day rather than all of them. I do believe Paul is focusing on Christians because he's speaking to Christians, seeking to comfort them with these truths, but we're going to look at those things as we proceed. Now, again, this morning we saw that as king, our Lord Jesus Christ brought his judgment against the unbelieving Jews in 70 AD because of what they did to him, because of their hatred, their rejection, their betrayal, their handing him over for crucifixion. I mean, after all, Jesus was the fulfillment of everything that God had promised to Israel, everything they had been waiting for, everything they had been hoping for, even from the very beginning. The Father finally sends his Son into the world, and they take him and they nail him to a cross. Now, we were reminded already this evening that even though this was God's plan, even though this had to happen in order for us to be saved, what they did was still the greatest crime ever committed. And so the Lord judged them for it. But remember, Jesus only brought this judgment after giving them many opportunities to repent and believe. He did send the gospel to them for 40 years, after all. Now think about all the privileges the Jews had throughout their entire history. God had entrusted his word to them, but they did not believe it. He sent his son to them, but they killed him. He showed them the empty tomb, but they paid the guards to cover that up. He sent them many witnesses after Jesus rose again from the dead, but they didn't believe them. As I've already mentioned, he sent his apostles to preach the gospel to them throughout the entire Roman Empire over a period of 40 years. But they mistreated, some killed others, and still would not listen. Not that all of them didn't listen. There were those who did believe, but there were many who didn't. Now, sometimes we might tend to think that because the Lord doesn't send his judgment right away, or at least in a way that we recognize it, that he really doesn't take sin seriously, that he really doesn't care what it is that people do. But we know that that isn't the case. The Lord does show patience. He allows time to repent, but he does eventually bring judgment. And let's not also forget what we hinted at this morning, that 70 AD was really just a picture, just a shadowy type of what the Lord is yet to bring one day on the entire world. The Bible says there's another judgment that is coming, one that's going to take place at the end of history, when Jesus will gather together everyone who has ever lived, including the Jews that he judged in 70 AD, including the people of this world that he judged in the days of Noah, and everyone who has ever lived. And he will gather everyone together for the final judgment and the final separation, and our Lord Jesus himself will judge them. That's part of his privilege as king. Jesus tells us in John chapter 5, verses 21 through 23, "For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, even so the Son also gives life to whom he wishes. For not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment to the Son, so that all will honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him." He gives him the prerogative to judge so that men will fear and men will honor him. Now this evening, I want us to look at this coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in judgment at the end of the world. I want us to see at least what we can know about when he's coming, what's going to happen when he comes, why he's coming, and then we'll close with some application. Now, first of all, let's ask the question, when is Jesus coming? Now, it shouldn't surprise us to learn that we don't know the exact time, obviously. Now, we might be tempted to think that Jesus doesn't even know when that time is going to be because of what he says in Matthew 24, verse 36, "But of that day and hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone." Now, if you followed what we were talking about this morning, this is Matthew chapter 24, and if Matthew 24 is really speaking about his coming in judgment in 70 AD, then what Jesus was speaking about here was his coming in judgment against Jerusalem that he was not aware of what that time would be, because he was still on earth. He had not yet ascended to heaven. He was not yet glorified. I think we should assume that now that he's at heaven, and that he is in full control of all things, that now he knows. However, he still hasn't told us. We still don't know the day or the hour, but we do know generally when he's coming. I mean, think about what I just read in this passage, what Paul was writing to the Thessalonians. "But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that day would overtake you like a thief." Now, I think it's interesting because when Jesus was talking in Matthew 24 about his disciples being ready for the judgment against Jerusalem, he said they needed to be on guard at all times because it was going to come like a thief at a time when they were not expecting it. But here he says with regard to this coming, "You are not in darkness that day would overtake you like a thief." They do know something of what it's going to be like when Jesus comes. So what is it that we should be looking for? Well, again, we can only speak in generalities. We do know that Jesus is going to come when the last Jew and the last Gentile that he intends to save has been saved, when the Lord has gathered in all of his sheep. Remember, he said, I have sheep that are of this fold, but I have sheep of another fold that I have to bring into this fold that haven't been brought in yet. But once all the sheep are complete, our Lord Jesus will come. So when he is saved, all that he intends to save. And there is certainly a body, a people, a group that he intends to save. There is going to be a last one. And when that one comes in, he will return. We also know that he's going to come when the Father has fulfilled his promise to his Son to subdue all of his enemies under his feet. Remember what David writes in Psalm 110, verses 1 and 2. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. The Lord will stretch forth your strong scepter from Zion, saying, rule in the midst of your enemies. When that last enemy is subdued, Jesus is going to come again. But I would remind you again that the last enemy that he will subdue is death. And that one he subdues when he comes again. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 24 through 26, then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to the God and Father, when he has abolished all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be abolished is death. So when is Jesus going to come again? Well, he's going to come again when the last person that he is going to save is saved, and when all of his enemies are subdued under his feet. Now remember, there's two ways that our Lord subdues his enemies. We were once enemies, weren't we? The Lord subdued us, but he didn't do it through judgment upon us. He did it by judgment upon Christ. So there's two ways he subdues his enemies. One is by changing their hearts and bringing them to himself so that we willingly bow the knee to him. We're subdued to Christ when we willingly submit to him. But he also subdues his enemies by bringing them to their knees, perhaps not as willing as those whom he saves. But notice, the very last enemy is going to be death. And that brings us to our next point. What is it that happens when Jesus comes? Well, the first thing he's going to do is subdue death, because death is the last enemy. He's going to do it by, first of all, raising the dead. He's basically going to empty the tombs. Now, Paul, we already saw, wrote in our passage in 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 15 and 16. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. They will rise first before the second thing happens, which is when he gathers together all the living. So he continues in the next verse, in verse 17, then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall always be with the Lord. Now, it's after the dead are raised and all the living are gathered together, because remember, when they're gathered, we're not just, let's say if we happen to live until the coming of the Lord, we're not all just going to ascend, as it were, as we are now and just sort of be suspended in air. The Lord is going to change us. So we call that perhaps translation, perhaps glorification. We're not going to be the same as we were, and in a certain sense, that will be essentially our death, although it'll be a glorious death, right? It's appointed unto man once to die. And if we are still living when he comes, there's going to be that change. There's going to be that translation. So he's going to raise the dead, and he's going to gather the living. And when he has done that, essentially, death will be overcome. When I say death, it's not obviously the same kind of death that's being referred to here. It is a change and a transformation. It's the closest thing we're going to experience to it. But this is going to be the final putting away of death, because the tombs are going to be emptied and the living are all going to be changed, and there is going to be no more death, at least death in that physical sense. Now, Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 through 55, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, 'Death is swallowed up in victory.' O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting?" So when Jesus comes again, he comes to vanquish that last enemy. That last enemy is death. He does it by resurrection. He does it by translation. Now there is no more physical death. There is still the second death, and we'll get to that in just a moment, but no more physical death. Now, as I've already mentioned, this raising of the dead, this gathering of all people, is not just for believers, but it is universal. It includes all mankind. Now, we know that that's certainly true of the resurrection. We've already read about that in John chapter 5, verses 25 through 29, where Jesus says this, "Truly, truly, I say to you, an hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For just as the Father has life in himself, even so he gave to the Son also to have life in himself, and he gave him authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man." We're going to look at this again in just a moment, but this resurrection he's referring to here is a spiritual resurrection. It's that new birth. It is the first resurrection. But then he goes on to say this, "Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming in which all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and will come forth." That is, all will hear, all will come forth, all who are in the tombs. "Those who did the good deeds to a resurrection of life, those who committed the evil deeds to a resurrection of judgment." Now, this isn't 2 hours. This isn't a time that is separated by a large period of time. There is an hour, a time coming, when all who are in the tombs are going to hear him and are going to be raised from the dead. So this is a universal resurrection. Now, I think we should assume that when he also gathers all the living, as he clearly tells us he's going to do, at least with regard to Christians in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, that at the same time he's going to gather all the living and not just believers, because of the reason that he is raising and gathering everyone together. And the reason he is doing that is because he is bringing about the final judgments. Okay, that's what the second coming is all about. The Lord raising and gathering to gather them all together for that final judgment. Now, it's not as if the Lord kind of put his judgment on hold between 70 AD and the present. Paul tells us that he is constantly judging, constantly pouring out his wrath upon the wicked. He writes in Romans 1, verses 18 and 19, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them." And then it goes on to say that even though they knew him as God, they didn't give thanks and so forth, but they worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator. God judges sinners continually. That's what Paul is telling us here. The wrath of God is continually revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness. Now, what that means is simply this, that all the disease that we have to face in the world, all the war, what's going on with North Korea, the threat of nuclear war, the fact that they're threatening us, all the immorality that we see going on, all the perversions from the natural order, all the so-called natural catastrophes that we have to face today, They are the result of man's sin, but they're the result of God's wrath. God is giving us over more and more to ungodliness so that he might judge this nation more and more. So judgment is continually ongoing. I mean, there may have been a more severe and quick judgment against the Jews in 70 AD. This judgment may be slower, but it is perhaps, well, it's severe. Okay, what's going on in this country right now is severe, and unless they repent, they are going to suffer for these things. But there is a final judgment that is coming, when everyone who has ever lived will be gathered together, as I've said at one time, and everyone is going to be separated into two groups, and all will be judged on that day. Jesus tells us in Matthew 25, verses 31 through 33, "But when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them from one another as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he will put the sheep on his right and the goats on the left." Now, Jesus refers to judgment, to this judgment, and really to judgment in general, to the fact that this day is coming. He refers to it as the judgment, and I think that that's very interesting. Even as the resurrection, I didn't mention this before, in Scripture is referred to as the resurrection. Now, the fact that it's referred to as the judgment and the resurrection means that there's really only one. Because if there was more than one, then they would have to be distinguished. Which one are you talking about? But listen to what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 12, verses 41 through 42. "The men of Nineveh will stand up with this generation at the judgment and will condemn it because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here. The queen of the south will rise up with this generation at the judgment and will condemn it, because she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and behold, something greater than Solomon is here." Jesus also says in Luke 10, verses 13 and 14, "Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, which occurred in you, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes, but it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the judgment than for you." Now, I would ask you, which judgment is Jesus talking about here? Well, he's talking about the judgment. He's talking about the only judgment that takes place. If there were many judgments, he would have to tell us which one he's referring to. But he doesn't, because there is only one. Now, at that judgment, Jesus is going to be the judge. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5:10, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ." I've already mentioned earlier, the Father has entrusted all judgment to the Son. He will have that honor so that all men may honor him, even as they honor the Father. And on that day, Jesus is going to judge everyone who stands before him according to what they have done. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5:10 again, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad." Same thing happens as John describes the final judgment in Revelation 20, verse 13. "And the sea gave up the dead which are in it." Again, think about general resurrection, about an hour coming when all who are in the tombs, all who are dead, are going to come forth. "The sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every one of them, according to their deeds." Jesus tells us the same thing in Matthew 25, sheep and goat judgment, that they will be judged according to the things they did or did not do. And then he is going to reward or punish everyone accordingly. Paul writes in Romans chapter 2, verses 4 through 11, "Or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance? But because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, again, the day, who will render to each person according to his deeds. To those who by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. But to those who are selfishly ambitious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, wrath, and indignation. There will be tribulation and distress for every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also of the Greek, but glory and honor and peace to everyone who does good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for there is no partiality with God. Now again, I would remind you that Paul is not saying here, Jesus is not telling us when he talks about the sheep and goat judgment, that the righteous are saved by their works. They are not saved by their works. Their works simply show what kind of a person they are, that they are redeemed by the Lord, that they are living like Jesus. But the wicked are condemned for their works. They will receive exactly what they have earned. Jesus said that even every idle word that men speak will be brought up against them on the day of judgment. That is, if they are not trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then finally, following the judgment comes the final separation. Jesus says in Matthew 25, verse 34, then the king will say to those on his right, the sheep, the righteous, the ones who were doing what he had called them to do, the ones who were following his example, come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. He's talking here about the eternal kingdom of God. So we need to see that either just before the judgment, perhaps after the Lord raises the dead and gathers all the living, or sometime during the judgment, the Lord is going to bring about that reversal of the curse on the creation that he talks about in Romans chapter 8, in 2 Peter chapter 3, where the elements are going to melt with fervent heat and the Lord is bringing about a new heavens and a new earth. And then those who have put their trust in the Lord Jesus and those who show that they have by the way that they live will hear this divine benediction as the Lord welcomes them into that kingdom that he has prepared from the foundation of the world. But he will say to those on his left, to the goats, to those who didn't do his will, to those who did not trust in the Lord Jesus, depart from me, accursed ones, into the eternal fire, which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. And he says, these will go away into eternal punishment. So again, the point is simply this, that our Lord Jesus Christ as King has been given the prerogative to judge. And he judged basically throughout the history, but particularly in 70 AD when he brought judgment upon the Jews. Every judgment that has fallen upon any nation has come from the hand of Jesus. What we're going through right now has come from the hand of Jesus. And one day he's coming again to bring about the final judgment where he's going to judge the entire world at one time according to what they've done, and he's going to bring about the final separation at that time. So that's his prerogative as king, and one of the ways in which he continues to minister really to us from heaven, because really when Jesus is subduing his enemies, he's really subduing our enemies. And as we read this, we do have the promise for which we should be thankful, that one day all of our enemies are going to be subdued. There is going to be an end to the things we see going on now. There's going to be an end to the wickedness that we see all around us. One day everything is going to be set right. The Lord is going to scour the world of the wicked. He's going to remove the curse from the creation. He's going to bring in a new world where there is nothing but perfect love and righteousness and peace. So things may be hard now. Things may be uncertain now. But one day, they won't be. One day we're finally going to be in a place where there is no danger and only glory. And let's not forget, the Lord has given us a promise to help us get through this world. He's going to watch over us. He's going to protect us. He's going to keep us in His care. But we need to keep our eyes fastened upon Him. Secondly, realizing that there is a day of judgment coming, we also are going to have to stand before the Lord to give an account for what we've done. But the good news is, if we've trusted Jesus, we don't need to be afraid of that day. The only fear we might have is if we're afraid we haven't trusted Jesus. But if we have, we don't need to be afraid because of what we saw this morning in the Lord's table. Jesus has already been judged at the cross in our place. Our sins have already been punished. They've been paid for. When we stand before the Lord on that day, we will stand blameless in the Lord Jesus Christ. Jude writes in Jude verses 24 and 25, "Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of His glory, blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen." I do believe that Jude is telling us here, and this certainly isn't the only place in Scripture where we're told this, that in the Lord Jesus Christ, all of our sins have been removed. There are things that we've done in our lives that we should be ashamed about, you know, things we know we've done that are sinful. But those have been washed by the blood of Jesus. We will stand before Him blameless on that day. We don't have to be afraid. Our sins are going to be paraded for everybody to see because the Lord has taken care of all those things. And that brings us to the next thing. There is something the Lord will judge on that day in us, not our sins, but rather the things that we have done for His glory. He will judge our good works, the things that He has done through us for His glory, the results of His grace within us, because again, we have something to do with that. Remember, sanctification is working with God and submitting to Him and agreeing with Him as He works in our lives to make us more like Jesus and actually to do things that are honoring to Him. So how well we have submitted to the Lord, how well we have cooperated with Him, how well we have let Him work through us, how much we have given, as it were, to Him according to what we have. Again, remember the widow's mite? The widow threw in like a couple of pennies to the treasury, and Jesus said she gave more than everyone else because she gave all that she had. It's according to what one has and not according to what one doesn't have. So what we do with what the Lord has given to us is what will be judged on that day. And of course, knowing that that's going to happen, then we should attempt to do as much as we possibly can do for the Lord, because our only opportunity to do anything is in this life. So let's use this life as best we can in order to bring glory to Him, that on that day we might receive a full reward. By the way, it's interesting, if we had had the time, and we didn't have the time really because it's too lengthy a passage, but if we were to read Matthew 25, we would notice that Jesus singles out one kind of work in particular that He's going to use to distinguish the sheep and the goats, and it reminds us that this in particular is important to Him, and that is how well we have served those who actually belong to Jesus. You know, inasmuch as you've done it to the least of these brothers of mine, you have done it to me. Not just to mankind in general, although the Lord does want us to serve mankind in general, but as we have done it to these brethren of the Lord Jesus. And as I read that, I couldn't help but think about Sinclair Ferguson, the upper room, when Jesus knelt down and washed their feet. And then when Jesus got up again to the table, He says, "I want you to do for one another what I have done for you. I want you to serve one another. I want you not literally to wash one another's feet, unless, of course, they need to wash their feet in that particular culture and so forth, but I want you to care about one another. I want you to help one another." Paul tells us that while we have opportunity, we should do good to all men, but especially to those who are of the household of the faith. the Lord intends for his body to minister to the members of his body. And that means not only the people who are here, but those who name the name of Jesus wherever they may be. So that in particular is precious in the eyes of the Lord, and we should think about how we might better serve one another in preparation for that day. And then finally, we need to remember that there are still many people who aren't in the body of Christ, who are out there, who aren't ready for this day, who are still in danger of judgment, of hearing the words of the Lord, "Depart from me, you wicked, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels." The only way that they can escape judgment on that day is by listening to Jesus' voice as he speaks through the gospel. Again, I would point you to John chapter 5, verses 25 and 26, where Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, an hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For just as the Father has life in himself, even so he gave to the Son also to have life in himself." Jesus spoke in those days, and those who heard him lived. Now, Jesus still speaks today, and the way he speaks is through the gospel. And those who hear his voice in the gospel are raised from death to life. I believe that what Jesus is referring to here is what John later tells us in the book of Revelation is referring to the first resurrection, the spiritual resurrection. There's a first resurrection, that is from spiritual death to life, and there is a second resurrection, which is the raising of the body from physical death to life that will take place when Jesus returns. Now, John tells us that if we are a part of the first resurrection, if we hear the voice of Jesus as he speaks through the gospel, and we are raised to spiritual life, we do not have to be afraid of judgment. Listen to what John says in Revelation 20, verse 6. "Blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Remember, the second death, there's a first death, physical death, and there's a second death, which is eternal death. And that ultimately is in the lake of fire. If you're a part of the first resurrection, if you've been spiritually raised to life, you're safe in Christ, and you don't have to be afraid of final judgment. You will pass through the judgment. Now again, since the only way anybody is going to hear the voice of our Lord Jesus Christ is through the gospel, and since we are the ones who have the gospel entrusted to us, we need to try to do as much as we can to bring the gospel to as many as we can. I mean, not only will we be loving our neighbor and serving them by bringing the gospel to them in order that they might be saved and escape judgment, not only are there people who are going to be saved if we do this from judgment, but in doing this, we will also bring greater honor to Jesus who calls us to do this. And as we do that, on that day when we stand before him, we will receive a greater reward because our reward is based upon what we do in this life. So, if you want a greater reward, share the gospel with more people. The most important thing is Jesus calls us to do this. This is what he desires. This is his will. So we need to seek to do that to as many as we possibly can. May the Lord give us grace to do that. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer, shall we? And let's ask the Lord to help us to do that.